Meantime, the second quarter starts on an up note for the U.S. markets as better than expected ISM and Chinese PMI data ease concerns about a manufacturing and economic slowdown in Europe. Now, April has historically been a positive month for stocks. In the past 5 years, in fact, the S&P 500 has seen an average gain of 4.5%. Joining us now to talk a little bit more about it is Ken Kamen, president of Mercadien Asset Management, and still with us, of course, our guest host, Steve Forbes, chairman and editor-in-chief of Forbes Media. Ken, let's go ahead and kick it off with you. You know, the way we teased to this segment before was saying that, you know, our next guest says we have to take some of that money out of the mattress and invest it back into the stocks. But if you are an investor who hasn't really been in this market with the Dow over 13,000, would you want to get in now?
Well, we're seeing corporate balance sheets continue to strengthen. We're seeing signs of health. Employment numbers are doing well. But when you say the word have to get back in, I think people are kind of being forced their hand a little bit. Because if you go back, a lot of people 3 and 4 years ago in panic mode started throwing money in the mattress, i.e. the bank, and buy 3-year CDs, 5-year CDs that are now starting to roll out. And they're faced with, do we roll it into a near zero rate interest environment? So there's all this money that's kind of from the retail side, not the institutional side. The institutional side is a bunch of professionals that have to beat a benchmark by, you know, some basis points or come on the air and explain why they didn't. Individuals are faced with the daily question of, what do I do with this pool of money, which is my retirement assets? And in many cases, it's being handed back to them from banks at what they maybe have locked in 3% 3 years ago. Now they're going to be looking at 1%. That's going to push people a little bit further out on that risk schedule, whether they want to be or not.
And that's an interesting point, Steve, that I want to bring you in on. Look, when we look at what President Obama has done, you can say a lot of things about his administration, but he was handed a financial crisis and the markets are doing pretty well. So what do you say about that?
Well, the markets still haven't recovered from what they were in, mostly in 2008, not to mention 1998. And if we had a vigorous economy, if he had not done all these programs that hurt the economy, you'd see a much higher market today. The yields are extraordinary, first time since the 1950s, as Ken pointed out. You can earn more on a stock than on the company equivalent company bond. And so the market, in essence, has been treading water for 12 years. I think there's a huge breakthrough to come if people really have confidence in the economy. There's literally tens of billions, hundreds of billions of dollars in that were used to be in equity funds that are still sitting on the sidelines waiting, is it safe to go back in?
Okay, so go ahead.
And I also think to add to what you're saying is one of the problems of the Obama administration is it's been a narrative of anti-investing. It's like villainizing people with money and investors. That is not the climate you want to kind of put risk on, if you will.
Sure.
And I think that if we just start looking at some pro-growth strategies, which you were talking about earlier, and people start internalizing that maybe that'll happen, that we'll start not demonizing capital formation, that could actually be a real positive for the market.
You saw such a huge contrast between the private sector, which cut back, got its act together, increased productivity, and the government sector, which just bloated.
Absolutely.
Guys, aren't entrepreneurs and business people supposed to just deal with whatever the environment is and invest and make the best use of capital and you know, I mean, why does the climate make political climate make such a difference? I mean, if you're in the business of being in business, isn't that just you just go out and do whatever you're supposed to do?
Well, one of the things that businesses are faced with now is what I call a tsunami of uncertainty at the end of the year. New Year's Eve rings in a whole bunch of changes if things don't kind of loosen up a little bit. Not only the Bush tax cuts sunsetting, excuse me, on individual tax rates, but this differential between dividends and capital gains is a big difference to corporate America and investors about how they're going to deploy their capital. You know, look at the potential for M&A. There's so much money sitting on balance sheets. If they create this big differential between dividends and capital gains, you probably see a lot more M&A activity where companies will start putting that capital to buy companies rather than get double taxed and kick it out to shareholders. So your point is right. Companies have to manage, but the uncertainty of regulatory change and the tsunami of uncertainty, as I said, at the end of the year is really causing a lot of companies to just sit on their hands and take a wait and see attitude.
And that could that be an explanation as to why we might see some of the earnings reports being positive and see companies growing, yet at the same time they're not hiring aggressively?
Yes, because, again, they're not sure of how durable this recovery is going to be. And you may be a business person, you may want to put capital to work, but if you don't see a real return, you don't know what kind of dollars you're going to get back with the Fed continuing to weaken the dollar. Guess what? You're going to be very cautious, or you're going to ship it overseas to places like China or other parts of Asia where you see a much better return, immediate return. And in terms of long-term investing, you're not going to do it until, again, if the dollar's going to be stable, okay, you'll do an investment that may not pay off for 7 or 10 years.
Right. So companies certainly treading lightly. Ross, over to you.